drugs and alcohol are everywhere, but did you know they've changed world history? We're taking a look back in time now with author Eamon Evans, who's been doing some research on the matter. Eamon, welcome back to Studio 10.
Hey, how are you doing?
Fabulous, thank you. Now, the pyramids apparently were built by workers who drank beer, and what does that tell you about civilization?
Well, yeah, beer was the money of ancient Egypt. Essentially, the Nile wasn't something you could drink from and sort of live to poo the next day. And so, yeah, it was money. It founded that civilization. It was why people worked. It was what people drank. But yeah, I mean, you can go back to, you know, civilization itself. The reason why we sort of stopped hunting and gathering and settled down in villages, which became cities and so forth, was to grow grain, and arguably the reason we grew that grain in the first place was not for bread, but in fact to drink beer.
Wow.
That's right.
Now tell us about Adolf Hitler and Winston Churchill. Were they on serious drugs during the war?
They were both on very serious drugs during the war, along with a great many of their soldiers. I mean, one of the sort of figures about World War II you don't hear that much is that the Allies produced something like 150 million amphetamine tablets and distributed them to their troops, and
wow,
the Nazis were well over 200 million. Blitzkrieg was accomplished by soldiers on speed. Churchill and Hitler themselves, Churchill, as is well known, started every day with whiskey and champagne and then really got stuck in. and the reason why this sort of, you know, overweight 70-year-old workaholic was able to, you know, function on 20 plus drinks a day was because he had his little pills, his little green pills, his little blue pills, both of which were amphetamines. And Hitler, obviously a nutbag from hell, but arguably he was nuttier still because he had upwards of 80 drugs a day after 1941, including things like codeine, morphine, bull semen, and you
bull
know,
semen.
Bill
how
Sanders.
Do you have that on with ice cubes?
Injections.
Wow.
But yeah, the his most sort of frequent injection were the daily dose of crystal meth, and those sort of final sort of pictures that you see of Hitler, where he's sort of pale and sweaty and covered in goosebumps. It's essentially because the Allies, en route to Berlin, had bombed the final factory which made the Führer's crystal meth, and he was coming off drugs.
Jeez.
Wow.
See,
I keep telling people ice is bad for you and no one listens. Now, there are theories that alcohol also played a part in the assassinations of US Presidents JFK and Abraham Lincoln.
Yeah, I think that's safe to say. I mean, Abraham Lincoln famously was shot while watching a play. What's less well known is that he was left unguarded with his back to an unlocked door. The guy that was supposed to be guarding him, obviously not a theatre fan, got bored, went next door, started to drink at the pub. Someone else at the pub was John Wilkes Booth, who was getting some Dutch courage together, and when he was sufficiently pissed, stumbled into the theatre, opened that unlocked door and went bang.
Wow.
JFK,
yeah.
I mean, who knows what really happened that day, but what something you can say with certainty is that he wasn't very well guarded. The 28 sort of Secret Service agents that were there to guard him somehow failed to notice a gun sticking out of a window, sort of some 80 yards away, somehow failed to sort of act after the first and second shot to guard him. And maybe, just maybe, this is somehow sort of to do with the fact that half of them were up until 5 o'clock that morning drinking in a pub, and
really?
Then all of them started work before eight. And so maybe, just maybe, they weren't on top of their game.
Wow.
Oh, and so maybe too they needed some good hangover cures. You found some pretty bizarre ones. Tell us about those.
I think I need a good hangover cure, to be honest. there's been some crazy ones over the years. Ancient Rome, you had your deep-fried canary. Sicily, to this day, they're a fan of dried bull's penis. In Mongolia, some parts of Mongolia, they prefer pickled sheep's eyeballs in tomato juice. And in Hungary, at least until quite recently, people like sparrow droppings in brandy.
Until recently?
Oh, apparently so. I mean, maybe the logic is that it'll induce vomiting. I don't know.
No.
I mean, it'll certainly induce vomiting in me.
If you're a bull, you'd be treading pretty nervously in Sicily, wouldn't you? Now, you very also much. Found some really strange liquor laws across the world, eh?
Yeah, all sorts of things. I mean, in Scotland, technically you can't ride a cow when you're drunk. I'm not sure if you want to ride a cow. In Thailand, it's illegal to drink in the morning. Obviously, in lots of the Middle East, it's illegal to drink at any time. In Turkey, you can't drink on election day, though the way that country's going, they probably won't have election day soon, so that won't be a problem. And, yeah, in Sweden, you know, you can only the government can sell booze over 3.5% alcohol. And, I mean, in Russia, up until a couple of years ago, beer wasn't even considered alcohol, and so...
A
10-year-old could buy it just as easily as they could buy a soft drink.
There you go. Interestingly, also, India, on their national day, you are not allowed to drink alcohol, or you're not allowed to sell alcohol, and their national day is January 26th, Australia Day.
There you go.
Yeah, a very strange thing.
It is so fascinating talking to you, Eamon, and you can read more of these amazing stories in Eamon Evans's book. It's called Tanked. And for everyone in our studio audience this morning, you're all going home with a copy of the book.
Oh!
Yay! Eamon, thank you so much for joining us. Always great to chat.
My pleasure.
Thanks.